All right, let's begin the talk then. So, we are continuing with A Song of Awakening by Yongjia. We've spoken about the view, and we will continue to talk about practice. So we've gone over several verses with my commentary, and we'll just continue to the next one. You all can hear me all right? Okay. Okay, the text goes. For the superior, one breakthrough accomplishes all. For the middling and inferior, the more they hear, the less they believe. You only need to discard the dirty garments within. No need to flaunt your diligence to others. So the first two lines actually goes with the previous verse. And this business about discarding dirty garments, you know, not flaunting your diligence, goes with what's after. So let me comment on the first two lines. So we've been talking about the Song of Awakening. With the view, we spoke about the experience of awakening, Buddhist awakening, and correct understandings of how things work, how things are, how one navigates through practice, through life. And what precedes this line last time I spoke was about all the traditional approaches to practice. Responding to conditions, adjusting one's practice to cultivate the three bodies, the Buddha bodies, the body of reality, truth, which is awakening, the body of merit from benefiting all beings, which is called the body of beatitude, and then the form body. Yeah. So this is typical Mahayana approaches to practice, speaking about the results of practice. But we spoke about the practice that leads to these. We spoke about the four wisdoms, which is eight modes of consciousness. Consciousness or cognitive moments that derive from sense faculties contacting sense object. So the first wisdom is the first five sense faculties. The second wisdom is the sixth sense faculty, which is the faculty of mind. Unawakened, its function is discrimination, right? Labeling, judgments. After awakening, it's transformed to the wisdom that discerns wholesome and unwholesome, and the various spiritual capacities of sentient beings. Right. The third wisdom, prior to awakening, is the workings of manas, which is the seventh consciousness. So you have five consciousnesses derived from five sense organs, six one. From the Buddhist perspective, the mind is a faculty. Right? That's the sixth. Seventh one is the ever-abiding sense of self-grasping. So after awakening, the self-grasping transforms to wisdom. Right? Wisdom of equanimity. Right? Now prior to that, when we are self-referential, there is no equanimity. Everything is assessed, gauged, judged through the lens of me, I, mine. So this is good. I like. That's not good. I don't like. So basically, there is no equanimity. After awakening, self is dissolved. Of course, we've spoken about this before. Self does not mean, you know, your personality changes or anything. It's just this grasping, right? This deluded assumption that there's something permanent, unchanging, separateness between all things, ourselves and other people, whereas the reality is we're intimately connected. We belong to the world. The world constitutes us. All the people in our lives, intimately connected. Also the past, present, and future. Not only people in our life, in our little small circle, all our predecessors were intimately connected. So when the self grasping, the sense of separateness, independence, right, deluded assumptions, some kind of permanence there, when that dissolves, that is selflessness. Nothing to do with personalities. Awakened people still have personality. They still have intellect. In fact, their thinking process becomes much more clear, and their ability to make connections, because what they have essentially realized is the interconnectedness. So their thinking process becomes freed from compartmentalized thinking, boxed way of thinking. So they can connect with, and there's nothing magical about it. They're able to make new connections, new beginnings. And that is the expression of equanimity. So that's the third wisdom, which refers to the self, the transformation of the self-attachment. The basis of the mental continuum, which functions like a repository, the alaya vijana. And prior to awakening, this is just a repository of all of our karmic impressions. All of our actions lead to repercussions in our mental continuum, biased. And based on, filtered through the self-referentiality. Right? So all the actions that leave impressions on our mind is basically flawed. So that repository bag, if you will, that mental continuum is just full of karma. Right? After awakening, the alaya transformed to the mirror wisdom. So this is, it's no longer conditioned by this repository. I'm using this metaphor of repository like a Santa Claus bag. You know, all the karma that we put in leads us to think in a certain way, behave a certain way. This bag of karma shapes us to be a certain type of person, right? A certain type of views, which is this impression of deluded, biased, self-referential karmic impressions. Right? You can call that presence. Right? So the Santa Claus bag is all this presence. After awakening, all of these karmic impressions, they don't disappear. Because karma essentially is history. There's a history to why you are the way you are. That doesn't change, the past doesn't change. Right? So what happens to all these karmic seeds? Because they're no longer filtered through self-referencing, all of the past events and history, they become resources for the function of wisdom and compassion, to be able to connect with all beings. So seeing everyone, interacting with people, becomes like a mirror, reflecting in a mirror. Mirror against mirror. All the beings reveal, like for example, seeing a very annoying person, right? Before, we don't like this type of person. Why? Because there's a history to why we don't like this type of people, right? There's a real history to it. So prior to awakening, we see them and it just kind of gets under our skin. After awakening, they are like a mirror to us. They reveal our shortcomings. They reveal what needs to be done. Just because a person is awakened doesn't mean they become perfect. No. There's a history to why they are the way they are. And everyone becomes teachers. Right? But because there's no self-referencing, you yourself, it's like a mirror. So mirror responding to mirror, infinite possibilities. So have you seen mirror reflecting against a mirror? Yeah, infinite possibilities, right? They mutually exist. They mutually exist in each other. Right? And that means all the people that we meet, we are a part of them, and they constitute us. And yet there is distinctness to us. So everyone is me, yet I'm not them. Right? Me is just a label for everyone, in other words. So mutually connecting, mutually interacting, mutually constituting, allowing each other to flourish. This is an unimaginable scenario for most people. Why? This guy is annoying. How is he constituting me? Right? He's not allowing me to flourish. He's blocking me, right? He's creating problems for me, right? Why? Because of me. Mine. It's blocking me, right? So in the self-grasping, the delusion, deluded way of thinking, the separateness vanishes. All the habit tendencies that we have in facing different types of people reveals to us what needs to be done. So they allow us to flourish. They are our path. They become our bodhisattva path. Does that make sense? Yeah. So that's what we were talking about before. Now, then it follows. For those practitioners of the highest caliber, the superior, one breakthrough accomplishes all. That means one breakthrough to awakening, these four types of wisdoms manifest. Right. And that is an inconceivable, unfathomable, kind of power, right? Historically, has anyone ever accomplished this? Yes! Shakyamuni Buddha. Right. And some Chan masters who've come close to this. So most Chan masters in the history of Chan Zen have gone through several deepening awakenings. Right? And the decisive awakening at the end would be something like this. Right? So, Shakyamuni Buddha was able to accomplish this. Now, what are the conditions that would foster such momentous awakening? From the Buddhist perspective, it's not something, these conditions, it's not something that's from this present life. So such a great practitioner has lifetime after lifetime of awakening, leading to the final birth of this final crescendo in which they breakthrough. Right? So whether we believe it or not, doesn't really matter. What's more important is providing the conditions. Now, what are the conditions? The conditions that guides our practice that aligns with wisdom and compassion. Now, what are the conditions that aligns with wisdom and compassion? That's the key. That's what we should be interested in. Right? I've already said awakening is this dropping away of self-referentiality. Right? So the very first thing is correct views. But most people navigate through life with the understanding that this is my opinions, my experience, you are different. A very strong sense of separateness. Separated through views, opinions, political affiliations, different ideologies. In fact, all of them have something in common, and that is words and language. All of the views, experiences are filtered through language. Those of you sitting on the corners, are you able to hear me? Because the acoustics here sometimes is not that good. Ma'am, are you able to hear me in that corner? Okay. All right. So, it's not that words and language themselves are problematic. We need that. It has helped us progress, advance, and create all kinds of wonderful things, innovations. The problem comes from grasping, identifying, reifying, solidifying these words as fixed, unchanging notions. Right? And the problem with words, the limitations of words, is that it is inevitably biased. That's the nature of language. The nature of language divides. Black is not white. Okay, at most there's a gray, right? Different shades of gray. But if it's gray, it's not white. If it's dark gray, it's not light gray. Good is not bad. Okay, what is something in the middle? Okay. Mediocre. Mediocre is not good, nor is it bad. It's something in the middle. So the nature of language divides.
segregates, discriminates.
In direct contradistinction to the wisdom of selflessness, the wisdom of interconnectedness. Words doesn't say black is constituted by white. From the Buddhist perspective, it is. You can't rationally think through it. All the colors or everything that you see, everything that can be touched, everything that can be experienced, exists because of other things. This gong exists because of non-gong. Particular metal, the factory that made it, the mold that shaped this, everything that's non-gong. This cup is made up of non-cup. Right? So words and language, the divisiveness of words, and on the basis of words, of course, we build our self-image, we build our storyline, we have all kinds of ruminations and narratives and ideologies rested on separateness. Discrimination. And the depth with which we are ingrained in the vested interest in words, how we identify with them, it is so deep. It is so deep. It is the way that we are reared. Our own self-narrative is constituted by this. Right? That people can think, oh, I'm shy. Right? I'm not good enough. Right? Some people think, I'm never good enough. Actually, it doesn't really match reality. Have you met those people? They're actually very capable. Right? But their self-image is completely different. Where did they get these ruminations, these ideas from? The very first view is to understand the meaning of things. Don't rely on words. Don't rely on words. Words are always inadequate. They're always inadequate. They can't even explain our experience of tasting water. Words can't even explain this to other people. You can try to explain, but when other people hear it, they will, based on your words, with their own interpretation of your words, formulate their own ideas of what water is like. It's just through and through miscommunication, through and through misidentification, through and through just not real. That's why Buddhism called that delusion. It's not that we're delirious or have a mental illness or something, but it's just it just falls short. Right? So the first correct understanding is to not rely on words. And all the stories that we build on the basis of our views, opinions, which are mediated through words. Mediated through words. What do we rely on? Meaning through direct observation. If we directly observe something, we will see interconnectedness. Floor is made up of non-floor. Guo Gu is made up of non-Guo Gu. Each one of you is made up of everything else that we're intimately connected. And as for concrete practices, the practice of generosity. That's in direct contradiction to what? Selfishness. Self-referentiality. See? So, generosity is connected to the function of wisdom and compassion. We don't practice generosity to, you know, boost our ego. I'm such a generous person, right? Or have pity on those miserable sentient beings who need our help. No. On the basis of the meaning, not the words. The meaning is we're interconnected. We're interconnected. So helping others, it's a natural response. It's a natural response. And it helps everyone. It helps everyone. Yeah. Helping the underprivileged, right? The disenfranchised, those who have no voice, right? Or limited agency. Because they are our path. They provide us opportunity to cultivate wisdom and compassion. Okay. So first condition, don't rely on words and language. Directly observe how things are. Second, generosity. Okay. It's through our actions. Support. We have a choice. Support the organizations, the people that need the most. Support others. It's like helping everyone, ourselves included. Second is this. Third, discipline. Discipline. That goes right against selfishness, self-referentiality. I want chocolate and I want it now. I want a whole box of it. I don't care about other people. You know. So discipline, behavioral discipline, right? Speech discipline, and discipline of the mind. What kind of information do we want to input? Right? So, discipline. That's the third. The fourth one. Diligence. Diligence. That goes against self-referentiality. Right. Diligent doing what? Diligent helping other people. Diligence doing something for the greater good. If you can align your work, your job, your research, your schooling with something that's benefit a lot of people, that's excellent. Excellent. Actually, a lot of work can do this, unless you're a, you know, arms dealer, right? Or something close to that. Anything from janitor, cleaning the toilet. So the next person that goes in, they feel refreshed. You just made that person's day. Excellent. Excellent. Right? From janitor to teacher to CEO to office worker. You know? Maybe your job is just Xeroxing. Every time after you Xerox, the place is spick and span. You just made someone else after you, his day or her day. Every time after you finish using the bathroom, the water is not everywhere. It's on the countertop, it's on the floor, you know, the tissue is not even in the toilet, not even in the garbage can, it's half outside. No. See? So the way we orient ourselves, carry ourselves in daily life, we keep the benefit of sentient beings, of living beings, close to our heart. If you keep that in mind, everything you do benefit. Right? A lot of people, you know, like, how many of you go to restaurants? And you have like takeout food, right? The waiter and the clerk give you napkins. You see the way they grab the napkins? It's like a whole wad of napkins just throwing there. You actually don't need that much, do you? Just waste. Keep the benefit of others in your heart. As you move through space throughout the day, the things that we use, frugality, practice, frugal. When we eat, we don't leave anything behind. We have a practice of eating. Those of you who've been on retreats would know. After we eat, we make natural soup. Do you know what natural soup is? We put water in the bowl. We leave a little piece of vegetable. We clean the bowl. So by the time we bring our finished dishes to the dishwasher at the retreat, spick and span, just a little bit of drop of dish detergent would take care of everyone's dishes. It's environmental protection. Keep sentient beings in your heart. Diligent, discipline. In the way you think, in the way you act, in the way you speak. That's cultivating the conditions of awakening. A lot of people don't want to do this. They just want the awakening. And they live like slobs, and they, you know, wasteful, and they're arrogant, selfish. The cause and effect doesn't match, you see? Right? So the conditions. The next condition. Patience, which counteracts control. The way we want to control things. This is a big one. It's a big one. Things don't go your way. Oh. Things don't go your way. You're getting on Zoom, the computer's not doing right. You know, crashes, giving Dharma talks, the microphone keep on making buzz noises. I don't know if today is making crazy sounds. You know, it's like this frequency is wrong, whatever. Patience. You know, be aware of our need to control things. Our way. If you keep sentient beings, people, in your heart, the benefit of others, the little things you do, when things are out of control, when things don't go the way we want to go, we have patience. It's not mean passive. We still exert our agency. What needs to be done must be done. For example, we are experiencing racial reckoning, right, in America. Things that need to be done, we have to do it. We can't say, I'm going to practice patience now. Let things flow and naturally change in its own course. No, we create the conditions for change. So that needs to do, we need to do that, right? There's a lot of things that we can do, right? The way we treat the elderly. Forget about the elderly, like your parents. The way we treat your parents. Like when you were a baby, food doesn't stay in your mouth, slobbing over, you know. When people get old, they kind of regress to, they can't hold on to the thing, they're not that mobile. And you're trying to, can you just do this? They sacrificed years of their life raising us, nourishing us. So the way that we treat our parents, right? Keep sentient beings in your heart. Keep the welfare, the benefit of others. That's the principle. Then these practices will unfold accordingly. And you'll be able to make new connections, new innovative ways to practice. Of course, to sustain this, we need clarity, we need discernment, and we need to have a stability of mind. And that is meditation. Meditation, the condition of meditation. Some people think, I don't need to meditate. I meditate in daily life. You need to meditate, right? The meditation that we do is an anchor because our minds are wild. And subtle. It tricks us into believing in our delusion. So in order to see through the veil of things, we need that kind of stability. Now, how does keeping sentient beings in your heart relate to that? It does. Right? When we practice, all the things that I've said, frugality, offering ourselves, consideration, all of that, when we practice, we begin to even treat the body in a different way. We begin to have new relationship with ourselves. When we have different relationship with others, we also have different relationship with ourselves. So when we see the tendency to control, patience, it's okay. When we feel that we're not good enough, that somehow we're never good enough, inadequate, and thereby we have to fight. Some people are fighting types. They have to fight to get their agency, fight to get their right. They've learned this because behind that is this sense of inadequacy. When we feel that, we don't follow these tiny little voice inside us. Voice of delusion. Right? Words and language. We don't depend on that. So, here you come again. It doesn't actually match reality. Most of these ruminations and ideas. So, embrace that. Accept that as part of our history. And then bring it along to your method of practice. Right. Return to the method. Not in an oppositional way. Never do that. But in an open, receptive way. Then these agitated tendencies, and habits, patterns start to dissipate. Because you're not adding fuel to them. So, meditation and wisdom need to cultivate wisdom. We spoke about views. Wisdom is you're already free. You're already good. You're already free. We don't delude ourselves. Obviously, we have shortcomings. Teachers have shortcomings. Everyone has shortcomings. But the shortcoming becomes opportunities. Well, we can improve. So they're not really shortcomings. You can give it another label, word. Opportunities, right? So obviously we have things that we need to improve. But we understand more and more, we start to appreciate ourselves that it's all good. It's all good. These things don't define me. The monologues that I have inside keep on telling me I'm not good enough. Or some people think I'm the best thing in the world. These monologues, they don't define me. They're just voices, right? Views, opinions. Keep sentient beings in your heart. Open yourself to everyone and also to these views so you understand how you have shaped yourself to be like this. These voices are very indicative. They're like signposts that tell us what needs to be done. So embrace them to your path. Right? But practice with the understanding that. Is there a need to practice? Yes. But not try to fix yourself in that oppositional way. There are areas that need improvement, but with the understanding that I'm already free. But these are the things that tend to hinder this freedom, this interconnectedness, this natural wisdom that's within me, this natural compassion that's within me. So these are conditions. So I've given you seven. The first one is the Chan view. The latter six is what is called the six perfections. Six perfections, so. Words and language, our attachment to them, don't attach them, right? And then discipline. I'm sorry, generosity, discipline, patience, diligence, meditation, and wisdom. These are the conditions that can bring us to be the type of practitioner that is of the superior caliber. It's very simple. There's nothing mysterious about it. And the most important thing is in all these seven practices, seven conditions, in my humble opinion, is the Chan view, which is the first one. Tackle the first one because it's so deeply ingrained in us, our attachment and identity with views, ideologies, notions, which is grounded in words and language. Recognize their limitations. They don't define us. This is in direct correlation with the seventh one, which is wisdom. Right? We're already free. And then the principle of lies in everything in between is what? Interconnectedness, but something very concrete, more concrete than interconnectedness. Interconnectedness, yes, is on a theoretical level. The practical, at the working end of practice, what is the principle? I've said it a few times, and I went like this every time I said it. Do you remember that? Phil? Huh? What? Don't look at you? Okay. Tom, what is it? Keep sentient beings in your heart. keep all the people in your heart, their benefit, their well-being, then you will fulfill these practices. You believe it? Yeah. Things that need to be done, still do it. You don't let people walk all over you. No. You don't do that. You keep them in your heart. But what needs to be done, for the sake of not let this person run over everyone else, continue to run everyone else, this person must be stopped. But you stop the person with loving kindness because you keep all beings in your heart. You don't make the person into an enemy or an opposition. The person also needs help. They can't help themselves. That's their survival mechanism. So when opportunities are there, try to change. Right? So wisdom, suspicion to words and language, and how we are obsessed and addicted to it, to define us, missing out on the wisdom part, which is we're already free. And in carrying ourselves through daily life, keep the benefit of others in your heart. In the little things that you do, your husbands, your children, departmental chairs, colleagues, workers, friends and family, and all the beings. Okay. That's the condition. Oops. Chan. It's a nice password. Okay. Now, why is it that, so for the superior, the highest caliber, it's not something that they've accomplished in this one lifetime. They've done this. This is their bodhisattva practice. So when they encounter the teachings, one breakthrough accomplishes all. For the middling and inferior, that's another business. Why is it another business? It says, the more they hear, the less they believe. Why? What defines the mediocre student and the inferior student is they hear a teaching, and they don't get the essence. They latch onto some, not the main point, like some lesser important point. They're distracted by something that's insignificant, and they miss the most important point, which I believe all of you have gotten, right? Words and language. We're already free. Keep sentient beings in your heart, in all your actions. That's the main point, right? So the middling and the inferior, they hear something and they end up with some conclusion. Yeah, we're all free. Yeah, frugality. I'm going to start practicing frugality now. Yeah, frugality. I did mention being frugal. You know, when we go to have takeout food, you know, people take napkins, they grab, so I'm going to practice from now on, don't take a bunch of napkins, just use a little bit. And they miss out on the main point. That's a sign of the middling and the inferior. Do you see what I'm saying? Some people are like that. And unfortunately, each one of us sometimes are like that, right? Especially when we encounter new ideas. All these wonderful teaching and we just, it's like this treasure trove, the Dharma, the teaching, treasure trove. And we come back with a lint. Instead of gold or gems, we come back, this beautiful cotton. It's like, what? You go to a treasure trove and you come back with cotton? You know, when the teaching, when we're not familiar with the teachings, it can happen. Why is it like that? Why is it that we do that? Because we've always come at things from our own particular angle. We only listen to what resonates with us. See? We haven't broken out of our shell yet. So we only see what we wish to see, hear what we wish to hear, in a biased way. In a biased way. So, the more they hear, the more confused they become.
Guo Gu, I think we should get rid of napkins. You know, I protest. We should not use napkins from now on. I mean, isn't that what you said? It's like, yes, I kind of did say that, but I didn't say we should get rid of napkins. You know, all kinds of strange ideas can come out when we don't get the main point. Right? You see? So for that reason, the cultivation of the Bodhisattva path becomes piecemeal, fragmented, distracted, and takes a long time. A long time. For example, Shakyamuni Buddha began his practice eons ago. Actually, he began his practice, this is from the sutras, the scriptures, the same time as Maitreya Bodhisattva, which is the future Buddha. According to the East Asian Huayan Avatamsaka Sutra calculation, 56 million years later, he will become the next Buddha. Right? All of us are gone. Right? But they began the same time. Why? You have to wonder why. Maitreya began not like Shakyamuni Buddha. Middling, inferior. The sutra says he was lazy. He kind of went on his own pace, kind of practice. And the difference between Shakyamuni Buddha, decisive breakthrough, that we are still benefiting from his teachings, to Maitreya, 56 million years apart. Now, I'm not going to say, don't be Maitreya. Because I'm not even good as Maitreya, right? But do you see the differences? Always try 120%, 200%. Everything you do. Everything you do. Everything you do. Your whole being is there. And within your chest. What is that? Bosom or something? Bosom, right? Within your bosom, all living beings, all present, past, present, future in this task. Whether it is cleaning the toilet or sharing some teaching, then you have the expedited path. If you say, well, I can do it tomorrow, you know, hang out here, I'm just enjoying my meditation a little bit. Shakyamuni, yeah, you can go ahead, just save all beings and do it. Then you become Maitreya, right? I'm creating bad karma now. You know, good and bad, maybe it's good, we don't know. The most important point. Two things. What is it? Keep sentient beings in your heart. Excellent. You can't just have that one thing. Otherwise, you keep sentient beings in Mahara, oh, so loving, and then everyone steps all over you. So you must have wisdom. What is the wisdom? Don't give in to notions, words, and language, because by nature, it's limited. It's divisive. It segregates. It discriminates. Right? And the other dimension of that is each of you is already free. All the six perfections is already present. It's already present in you. You just have to manifest it. And the way you manifest, 120% in everything that you do. That is diligence. Right? Don't be like a tidal wave, great diligence, and then exhaust yourself completely lost. Right? Be like a small river, continuous, or a droplet of water, continuous, and you can bore through a hole in a rock. That is diligence. Every moment. So, for the middling and inferior, the more they hear, the less they believe. What do they believe? Their own discursive thinking. So, these are the people that don't get the main point. Right? They trust in their words, the labels that they've learned, their own experiences. Which is just your angle, your take on this. Same people that's experiencing the same thing, they have their own ideas. Each one living in their own fantasy. Each one living in their own dreams. We have to wake up from the dream. Right? Don't live in your own dream, let alone living other people's dreams of you. Right? A lot of people, you know, I'm not good enough, and they... You know, they care a lot what other people think of them. It's not that we don't care what other people think of them. We're not selfish like that. We have all beings in our heart, right? But the judgments and stuff, the labels that they put on us, or the labels that we put on ourselves, there's a history to why we do that, but it doesn't define me. Right? Why? I'm already free. The 6, 7 perfections are already present. I need to manifest them. Through what? The work, the practice, what I listed out. Now, when we engage in practice, because these 6, 7 perfections are already within us, all we need to do, the text says, you only need to discard the dirty garments within. What are the dirty garments? I trust my own thoughts, my own views, my opinion is the best, it's most accurate. I am right. I am right. I'm in control. That's the dirty garments. Right? Other beings, they're not in my heart. I don't want to keep in my heart. That guy's a jerk. Right? Right? This, I do me, and he can do him. That's the dirty garment. Right? Don't keep sentient beings in our heart. What do we keep? Dirty garments. So all you need to do is to unveil your full potential. Perfection. The perfections that I spoke about. And as you do this, the next line says it so beautifully and clearly. No need to flaunt your diligence to others. You don't keep on saying, you know what? You're in my heart, okay? I do this for you, right? Just to know, just so you know, I'm compassionate. I keep everyone. You don't need to do that. Don't need to do that.
Mirror, reflecting mirrors. The images, whether you say it or not, the image is already there. Other people manifest their response to you, your response to them, readily apparent.
In Chinese, we call it 现成,
which has several flavors. In Japanese, call it genjo, like genjo koan.
Koan is circumstances, conditions of awakening. Right? Koan. So, genjo koan, 现成公案.
That awakening is never concealed. It's already present, here and now. And the 现成 has the quality of ready-made, already manifest. So everything already manifests as they are. We just need to remove the dirty garments to see. All right.
The next four lines are excellent. Excellent practice.
Right. So we're now on the practice part. We've gone over the lofty views and awakening and all that, wisdoms and stuff. At the working end of practice, this is it. Diligent, don't flaunt it. The next four lines, when criticized by others, let them wrong you. They will tire themselves trying to burn the sky with a torch. You are the sky. You are the vastness. You already freedom. When I hear abuse, it's like drinking ambrosia, elixir of immortality. Like they're providing the ambrosia of immortality. Right? Let criticism dissolve, and suddenly you enter the inconceivable. A difficult practice, that's what it takes. Now many people just want spiritual awakenings, supernatural powers, you know, all kinds of spiritual booms. Practice and meditate, you know. Meditation is nothing. It's nothing compared to genuine practice. Our practice must be seamless, integrated, must be whole, pervasive to every aspect of our action. It's not just meditation, putting your leg in a pretzel shape. That's nothing. That's the beginning baby steps. That's baby does this. To learn how to sit upright, right? Not be distracted. All you need to do is just deal with wandering thoughts. Right? The real distractions, the real manipulation is life. The annoying people that criticize you, right? The obstructions that we face. Changing our views around like a mirror responding to mirror. Your practice will be expedited. This is the sudden path of Chan. The sudden path of Chan. Throw you right into the deep water of life. That's what we practice. Not in a beautiful Tallahassee Chan Center, you know, clean air, meditate, everyone's so friendly here, supportive, you know. Do you know that everyone come to the Chan Center, they put on their best self. It's natural, right? When they go home, oh, it's another business.
A lot of people are like that. I was amazed one time. Being my teacher's attendant, we have these big patrons, financial supporters. In front of my teacher, they're like perfect bodhisattvas. And then one time, and they dress tamed, you know, shirt up to here, cover their bosom, you know, these women, and everything's perfect, you know. I had to do some errand in Manhattan. Go to Manhattan. I saw one of the ladies. Oh my gosh. She was dressed like down here, all the chest got the, what is that called? When the breasts are pressed together. What is that? Cleavage, yeah, cleavage. She was dressed in a cleavage. I mean, these are wealthy people. You know, dressed in a cleavage at the red light in a red Corvette, the latest model. When they come to the center, Toyota. What, you know, I looked at, I was like, I say her name, I was like, so-and-so? She's like, oh, sorry, Guo Gu Fa Shi. And I was just like, wow, that's a really nice car you have. It's a complete red, matching her dress with the cleavage. Totally different personality. I was just, this is a cognitive moment of cognitive dissonance. I was like, wow, that's how they live. That's how they live. You know, all the volunteers at the Chan Center, everyone wear uniforms. We have these white uniform, white with a Dharma Drum logo. You know, plaid, what is that, polyester pants. You know, ugly stuff. You know, oh, gosh, that opened my eyes. Sentient beings in their multitude of manifestations. You know, real practice, not financial support. Sure, we need money in order to do programs to help people, more people, yes. So we need patrons, but patrons need to practice. Everyone needs to practice in life. So all of you who come, after that experience, I'm no longer naive, I have to say. Everyone that come to the center with a beautiful face, you know, nice, and they're so respectful. I'm like, mm-hmm. I accept all beings. I accept everyone. I love everyone. But I understand people are complicated. They're complicated, you know. And how do we engage in practice? No need to flaunt it, but the way to practice, the way we respond to criticisms, that's the occasion when the mirror is mirroring a mirror. That's the occasion. It doesn't mean that let them wrong you, you can do whatever you want, and I'm just really passive. No. You do what needs to be done, what can be done. But as for your heart embraces all beings like the vast universe. That's how big it is. Encompasses all. So their criticism can be like burning the sky. Right? Hard to do, but that's what we aspire to. That's what we try to do.